So I did my BSc in mathematics from here. I got a gold medal for that, but 1 year before that I had flunked. So it was only on my second attempt that I managed to get a gold medal. And then I did my MS in mathematics from IIT Bombay. And after that, I thought it would be much more interesting to teach people meditation and make them happy rather than teach them maths and make them miserable. So, though if you come for my maths classes, you will find that they are also very happening. Yeah. Now, today I thought I would just go a little bit into ancient history. Yeah, and then come to where we are today. Okay, so all of you have heard of the Varaha Avatar? Yes? If you have not, which country are you in? The Varaha Avatar is when Lord Vishnu, right? He takes the shape of the boar, and then for some reason the earth is drowning in water. We don't know why and how, but the boar lifts the earth up and brings it out of the water, right? Saves the earth, so to speak. Right? Yes. Now, that may be a fantastic story and all that, but check out the shape of the earth. What is it? It's round, right? Which means that more than 10,000 years ago, we knew that the earth was round. Yes? Which Europe only accepted once they saw the Apollo pictures from space, right? In fact, we call geography bhugol, right? It is gol, round. Is it? It's not bhu tatte, right? Okay. It is bhugol. Okay. So we knew a very long time ago that the earth was round, and then we call the earth jagat. Jagat means what? Jiski gati hai wo, meaning that which moves. Right? So, we knew that the earth was round, we knew that it was not stationary, that it was moving. And this was thousands of years ago. Yes? Interesting, huh? Okay. Okay. Let's go a little bit into space. Now, there is this star called Antares. Okay? Antares. Ares means Mars. Red. This is also a red star, so it is called Antares. We like Mars. Okay? Now, it is the 15th or 16th brightest object in the sky. Alright. Yet, our elders, our ancients, they called it Jyeshta. Okay. Now, what does Jyeshta mean? You know what Jyeshta means? Jyeshta means the biggest, the oldest, the eldest. Now, why would they call the 15th brightest object? Meaning, there are many more brighter objects than this star in the sky. Why would they call it the biggest? Yes? Intuitively, something that is brighter should be bigger. Yes or no? Right? But they called this one, the 15th brightest, they called it the biggest. Turns out they were right. It is 40,000 times bigger than our sun. In fact, it is one of the biggest objects known to man. Yes? Now, just imagine. You've got this group of people who have managed to name a star the biggest. And this was 5,000-7,000 years ago. Yeah? Which is just a point in the sky. Okay? Okay. Not done with stars yet. Heard about the Great Bear, the Big Bear constellation? Yes? Okay. So, we are interested in that star. Okay? It is actually not a star. It is two stars. Yeah? Now, this itself is a big deal. To figure out that particular point of light in the sky is two stars. Okay? And it is called the Arundhati Vasishta. It's called Arundhati Vasishta. And in South India, there is a tradition where after marriage, yeah, the husband and wife are supposed to go out in the night and look at this particular star. Okay, now, funny tradition. Right? Okay. Now, most twin star systems rotate like this. Like one star is in the middle and the other star is going around it. This is definitely not the way a husband and wife should be. isn't it? Right? But Arundhati Vasishta, this particular system moves like that. Now, first, to figure out that that is a twin star system. Second, to figure out that it rotates in this way and not in that way. This is not something which is easy or obvious, is it? Yes? Third, to do it without telescopes. Yeah? Okay, metallurgy. Dinesh is B.Tech metallurgy from IIT Bombay. You know, there are these pillars which are rust proof in India. Do you know about them? The most famous one is in front of Qutub Minar. Yes? This is a 1,000-year pillar, 1,000 years old, and even the pollution of Delhi has not touched it. Yeah? It is still not rusting. Yeah? And the other one, this is near Bangalore in Kollur. Yeah? Where there is 750 centimeters of rain a year, 6 to 8 months a year, and this has been there for 2400 years. Yeah, and it is rust proof, no rusting. About the second pillar, what is more interesting is it was not built by any expert. It was built by the tribal, the aboriginals of that area to welcome Adi Shankaracharya when he came to their village. Yeah. So this technology was there, not even with like the learned Brahmins or something like that. It was available to the tribals. Yeah. Then there is this mystery of zinc. You know, India held the sole knowledge of how to remove zinc from zinc ore for 4,000 years. Yeah. Because zinc, it's a very, very interesting thing. Zinc from the ore, the zinc becomes liquid at 997 degrees Celsius, but that same zinc then vaporizes and becomes gas at 1000 degrees Celsius. So it is only a 3-degree window that you have to pull that zinc out, and it is incredibly difficult. Yeah, you know what we did? It was very interesting. See, usually if you see a furnace, kya hota, there is the furnace and then something is coming out and being accumulated, isn't it? This is the way most distillation is done, yes or no? You've got the heat from the bottom and something comes out and it is collected. Now, when the heat was coming from the bottom, what would happen? The zinc would become liquid, it would go down or it would just evaporate and go out, right? So what did these people do? They turned it upside down. They put the heat on the top and they put an ice bath below it, cold. So it would come down, then it would go in the cold, it would solidify and you would get the zinc. Yeah? For 4,000 years we kept this technique secret over here. Yeah? All the zinc in the world was made only by India. Nobody else could make it only. Yeah? Then one Chinese fellow stole it. Yeah? And then one British fellow stole it from the Chinese. There was this guy called William Champion who made the first zinc distillery in Great Britain in the year 1543. Before that, for 4,000 years, if you wanted zinc, you had to come to us. Now, this is a nice shloka in the praise of Lord Krishna. When you look at this shloka, do you think that there is anything special about it? It is like all other shlokas. Oh, Krishna, you are great, you are this, you are that. Yes or no? Right? Only thing is, there is this thing, there is a protocol called the Katapayadi Sankhya. Okay. Took me a long time to learn to pronounce that. Yeah. So there is this Katapayadi Sankhya where they give particular alphabets, particular numbers. So for example, Katapaya is 1 and so on. And then if you substitute these numbers in this shloka, you know what you get? The value of pi correct to 30 decimal places. Yeah, so we knew how to do encryption also. Yeah, acha, now don't you like this what I am talking about? So yes. Clap and tell me no. Ah. Yeah, you know, I am not used to just talking to an audience. I want audience feedback also. All right, okay. If you don't like it, then do like that. So I know. Now, recently I had been to Goa. And in Goa, there is this place called Vasco da Gama. You have heard of it, right? Now, why is Vasco da Gama called Vasco da Gama? Because there was this fellow from Portugal who came and supposedly discovered India. Right? Okay, let me tell you the true story. This story is in Vasco da Gama's own journal, which is there in Lisbon today. Okay. There were two guys who went searching for India. One of them was Christopher Columbus. The other was Vasco da Gama. Okay. Now, Christopher Columbus, he went in the opposite direction. From Europe, he went up. Okay. And he found America. Only he thought America was India. Okay. That is why the natives of Americans are called?
Indians.
That's where the Indian name comes. Because he thought, mereko India mil gaya. Right. So, he called those people? Indians. He called them Indians actually. Then the other people came and, you know, called them red because they were not white. Yes. So, that was Christopher Columbus' story. Vasco da Gama, he went in the opposite direction. If you know your geography, he came down from Africa. And he was too chicken to go out into the main sea. You know, he would only sail keeping the coast in view. Okay. And he was having the biggest ship available at that time in Europe. Alright. So, he came all the way down to the Cape of Good Hope. Okay. And over there, he was wondering, now how do I cross? Because from there to go to India, you have to go across the ocean, across the sea. Right? Over there, he met a Gujarati whose name was Kanha. Okay. He does not mention the surname. Possibly Patel. Okay. Yeah. So he met this Kana Bhai who was a trader from India, from Gujarat, who had ships 12 times the size of this ship. 12 times. And remember, Vasco da Gama's ship was the biggest ship in Europe at that time. Okay. He had ships which were trading ships, forget about military ships, trading ships which were 10 to 12 times the size of Vasco da Gama ship. And Vasco da Gama ship was escorted with three ships, like in formation, his ship was in the middle, those three of our Indian ships escorted this guy to Goa, to India. Yeah. So maybe we should call Kanha, no? Yes. No, I mean, we could go on and on and on. The amount of history, the amount of knowledge that this country had was phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. Yeah. And what was even more phenomenal was these guys had this knowledge 5, 7, 10,000 years ago. Yes. When Europe was still, you know, using bow and arrow to kill deer, our people were distilling zinc. Yes. Now, how did they have this knowledge? Yes? No, there is only one reason. All our scientists were saints. All of them did pranayam, all of them did yoga, all of them meditated. Yes? So, what happened was, because when you have trained your mind like this, when you have meditated, when you know how to do this, and you have done it for appreciable number of years, then you are no longer limited by physical instruments. If you want to go into outer space, you close your eyes, doom, you can go. If you want to go into the depth of the atom, you close your eyes, you can get there. And then you are seeing it, right? So it has to be accurate. That is how Arundhati Vasishtha turns out to be a twin star system which rotates around each other. Yeah? Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yes? That is how you can figure out how to make rust-proof iron. Which even till today we have not figured out. Yeah. So the basis of science is spirituality. Yeah. And this wealth that our country has, I will not say had, this wealth that our country has was systematically destroyed by the British when they came here. Yeah, they rewrote our history so that when they left us with a legacy of being ashamed of our own culture and our own tradition. Yes. You know, in Delhi, we know this very cute old couple. Uncle is 81 years old, auntie is 71 years old, and they will be celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary like next year. His father was the first Chief Justice of India. Bhandari, Mr. Bhandari. Yeah. So very well connected and all. So he went to all these British schools, and over there they would say, you know, yoga is for freaks. You should do PT. But unfortunately, do you see that even in today in schools you do PT, you don't do yoga? Yeah. So we have got independence, it's 60 years, but we are still thinking in those terms only. That is what the British wanted. Yeah. To break this country, they had to break the education system and break the traditions. If we want to build this country again, then maybe it is time to come back to learning, studying, yoga, meditation. Yes? Yes or no?
Yes.
Right? Okay. So then what is the technology of spirituality? How does the damn thing work? Yes? It's very interesting. There is something called tamas. Okay? There are three gunas. One of them is tamas. Now, tamas is good because it brings you sleep. A person who has no tamas cannot sleep. Yes? So, little bit of tamas is good. But have you noticed how tamas comes up when you really don't want it to come? Yes or no? Yes? You've got someone over here, you are sitting over there, and that person over here is talking, writing something on the board, and you're like, right? So that is unwanted tamas, isn't it? Yes. Now, what happens when tamas goes out of control? First thing is laziness and lethargy. Yaar, aaj kuch nahi karne ka hai. Hota ki nahi? Sometimes you will wake up in the morning. Now, if this happens once, twice, three times, four times, even five times a month, it's all right. Yeah? But if it happens regularly, then you get into the second one, which is procrastination. Baad mein karega. Baad mein karega. I'll do it later. I'll do it later. Isn't it? Yes? And that then goes into loss of, I'm not interested in anything, yaar. Kya bore ho raha hai life mein. Have you noticed how you say these words? So up till these first three, it is funny. But then it goes into depression. Yeah? You know, in America, an astounding 20% of the population, 44.3 million people suffer from depression. 44.3 million people. Yeah, this year alone, 25 million people went to a doctor to get treated for depression in the US. So it is not funny anymore. Are you getting what I'm saying? And then depression mein kya, phir modern methods are what? They sit and talk to you. Or they get Amir Khan to come and talk or give a speech to you. It's very easy for him to do it. No, he got lot of money. Or they give you drugs, antidepressants. So this only makes you feel worse, right? And then it goes into that last one, suicidal tendency. So a suicidal tendency or depression is nothing more than too much of tamas. Nothing more than that. Are you getting this? Yes? Okay, on the other side we have got rajas. Now rajas allows you activity, allows you to do, okay, everybody can you clap? Okay. Now, when you did that, how can you do that? Because you have got rajas. Now, she nodded her head. How can she nod her head? Because there is rajas. Yeah? So, the ability to act, the ability to do anything happens because you have got rajas. Do you get this?
Yes.
Yes? Now, when rajas goes out of control, what happens? First, okay, have you noticed that some people, right, they cannot ek jagah pe seedha baith hi nahi sakte, shake 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 shake, or that pen ke sath kichik 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 kichik, Have you noticed that? Huh? Cooler, no? Okay. So they cannot sit still. Then the second thing that happens is you close your eyes, so many thoughts come. Have you noticed? Has that happened? Aankh band karte, my God. Right? Yes? That goes into impatience and indecisiveness. I don't know what to do. What should I do? Should I do this? Should I do that? And you are continuously only thinking about what to do, so you don't do nothing. Happened?
Yes.
Quite regular?
Yes.
Yes. Now, up till here, again, like I said, it is funny. Yes. But that can get into irritability, which can go into anger and aggression, which can become violent. Yeah. Then certain time you just hit somebody, you slap somebody, you shout at somebody, you know, you become like a unpredictable walking volcano. Right? Nobody knows when you are going to erupt on them. Are you getting what I'm saying? Yes. And in extreme cases, we have all heard of this, no? Some kid goes and just generally shoots people. Yeah. And when that happens to your friends, it's not funny anymore. It's tragic, right? But this is just uncontrolled rajas. Now, uncontrolled tamas, violence to yourself, suicide. Uncontrolled rajas, violence outside, violence to others. Yes? Now, notice that both these are required. You cannot say, let us eliminate rajas and tamas. Then you can't sleep, you can't act. It is required. Rajas is required. Tamas is required. But in the proper quantity. When rajas and tamas are balanced, then what happens? Something very beautiful. It is called sattva. Okay? Sattva is purity, beauty. Yeah? See, when you see a beautiful sunset, how do you feel? No, that is sattva. That va is sattva. Alright? Do you get it? So, how do you know that sattva is high? Number one, when you close your eyes, you are not bombarded with thoughts. You can close your eyes and relax. Usually, when you close your eyes, then open your eyes. Right? You can close your eyes and relax. Second, you feel cheerful. People around you feel cheerful. Third, your efforts bear fruit very quickly. Have you noticed that sometimes you do so much work, yet it doesn't work? Yes. And other times you do very little work and you get so much?
Yes.
Happened, no? The second time, sattva was high. First time, sattva was not high. That is why you are working, it's not working. Are you getting this? Yes? So, what we call success and extreme good luck. Yeah? Sometimes it happens, no? The day goes so perfectly, everything just falls into place. Yes? Now, you want that kind of a day to happen more often rather than 3 times a year. Then you have to learn to meditate. Because what you do when you meditate, see, both all these three are snowball. When you start, tamas goes out of control little bit, suddenly it becomes big, suddenly it becomes very big. Yes, same with rajas. Have you noticed how anger comes so suddenly? You don't get angry slowly. Anger, bang, it comes like that, right? It is a snowball effect that happens. Similarly with sattva. Even sattva has a snowball effect. Okay, so dhire dhire as you rise the sattva, it snowballs and life becomes really fun to live. Okay, yes, so balancing out the rajas and the tamas and increasing the sattva, this is the formula for success. Okay, and this is what spirituality is all about. Spirituality is not sitting on the top of Mount Everest and chanting om and turning blue. Okay, spirituality is not generally renouncing everything as if you have anything to renounce also. Yeah, no, spirituality does not mean not having money. Okay, you know, in India, Narayana and Lakshmi are married to each other. Isn't it? Narayana is the lord of knowledge. Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth. Knowledge and wealth go together. Unko divorce nahi hai. Okay, so many people think, oh, spirituality means I should be poor. That's bullshit. Okay. If you are truly spiritual, then you are definitely rich. Check out my laptop. Yes. One thing I believe in, see, time will never come back, money will come back. So I always invest in the best that I can possibly invest in. Because money comes back, yaar, time doesn't. Are you getting what I'm saying? So excellence, pursuit, getting to be excellent, getting to realize your dreams, but at the same time, not getting stressed out and tired while doing it. This is spirituality. Okay? If you have had any other concept of spirituality, throw it out of the window. Okay? Because that's not it. All right? Okay. So now, would you like to increase your sattva a little bit?
Yes.
Shall we meditate?
Yes.
Yes? So about 7-8 minutes we will meditate. Okay, 7-8 minutes. All you have to do is close your eyes, sit comfortably and follow my instructions as much as you can without effort. All right. Suppose I say think of the color pink and all you can do is see blue. Don't go where the hell is that pink. Okay. You stay with blue, it's all right. All right? Okay? So absolutely no effort. You just sit relaxed. Yeah? And I will say a few things and you listen to. When you are meditating, you need to close your eyes. Okay? I give you my personal guarantee that the room will still be here when you open your eyes. Okay? So while meditating, don't... Okay? Everything will be right here. Don't worry about it. Okay? Yes? Is this all right with everybody?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, good. So let's sit comfortably. Let's close our eyes. How do you feel? You know how long it has been? Check your time. It's almost 20 minutes. Did you feel 20 minutes? Yeah? See, now at this moment, is anybody feeling even little depressed? Is anybody feeling even little irritated? Angry? This is the thing. Yeah? You balance the rajas and the tamas and you go into sattva, you start feeling good. It's as simple as that. Okay? It's so simple, yes, and yet it is so profound and powerful. Are you getting what I'm saying? Yes, and this is something that you need to learn. Yeah, no, it would be so nice to be able to increase your sattva at will. You are not having a good day, sit in a corner, do your meditation, do your pranayam. Good day has to happen. Samanvari Vat. All right. So this is a shakti, this is a power that is available to you, but you don't use it. Yes? You need to learn how to use it. Alright. Now, why do we want all this sattva business? Right? Everybody here wants to be successful? Okay. Let's understand success. What is required to be successful? There are two things that are required basically. One is what we call domain expertise, yeah, which means that if you are a doctor, you should know where the kidneys are. Or if you are an architect, you should know the difference between the floor and the ceiling. Right? Are you getting what I'm saying? Or if you are a chemical engineer, you should know that H2 stands for hydrogen. Things like that, domain expertise, yes, knowing your subject. Okay? This is one thing. The second thing is what we call soft skills, ability to handle stress, interpersonal relationship, confidence, ability to take decisions, clarity of thought, ability to communicate, all these things. See, you might have fantastic domain expertise, you might be the best in your field, but if you cannot talk properly, is it any point? See, you can study for 4 years in IIT, get your BTech, but then you have to sit across the table and convince that guy on the other side in 5 minutes that you know what you studied for 4 years. Yes or no?
Yes.
Right? So, what is required is these soft skills also. One side you need domain expertise. Another side you need soft skills. Now, there was a study that was done in Stanford where they asked extremely successful Stanford graduates, how much percentage do you attribute the success of your life to domain expertise and how much percentage do you attribute to soft skills? What do you think was the answer? More than 10,000 people were interviewed. Yeah, what do you think was the answer? No, percentage bolo na. How many? How many in domain expertise? How much percentage domain expertise? 20? 30? You want to know the result? This was what the successful people who were Stanford graduates said, that 87.5% of the success that I have in my life, I attribute to me being a nice person. Of course, you can be a very nice person and not know a shit about your subject and still not succeed. So this is important. 12.5% is important, but it is 12.5%. Now, if you check out the time, effort and money that you spend in developing these two, it is absolutely the opposite. Yeah, more than 90% of your time, effort and money goes into domain expertise. Study. Right? Very little of your time, effort and money do you invest in developing soft skills. Yes, this is why India today has become a country of the educated unemployable. Yeah, you know, Narayan Murthy, head of Infosys, actually wrote a letter to the Chartered Accountancy Association of India this year. He hired the top 10 graduates of CA, top 10. Within 6 months, he had to fire 6 of those people. Zero. Over here, cannot communicate, no clarity of thought, no ability to take decisions. He wrote a letter saying, what are you doing? What kind of people are you training? Yes? So, the way you are right now, are you geared for success? The effort, time and money that you are spending on your education, is it taking you towards success or is it taking you towards something else? This is a question you have to ask yourself. We have what we call the Yes Plus, the art of living. Yeah, we have what we call the Yes Plus program. Yes Plus stands for Youth Empowerment Skills. Okay, the Plus stands for people who are 18 and above became people who are 18 plus became plus. Okay, yes. This program was put together by me and Dinesh, of course, with the guidance of Guruji. Where, you know, we have been in Art of Living now for 19 years. This is my 19th year in Art of Living. Yeah, since 1991. So, 19 years. Right? So, we have been in 19 years. Dinesh is about 15, 16, whatever. Yeah? So, we thought that, okay, how would we give this knowledge, this spiritual knowledge to ourselves if we were 18? Now, we were not very, at least I was not such a pleasant person when I was 18. Okay, you know, you think you know everything, right? I knew everything. Okay. All right. So, we wanted to figure out a way to take all this knowledge, all that we have talked about, and put it in a way that will make a difference to young people. You know, because this time of life, you know, when you are between 18, 19, 20, this time is the most coveted time for everybody. See, people who are 13 and 14 want to be 18. Yes. People who are 35 want to be 18. Yes. Only people who are 18 don't want to be 18. Right? So we wanted to put together a workshop that would bring the fun back in being 18. Yes. You know, Priya has designed a very nice new poster for our Yes Plus. You know, it says the all new endangered species, a stress-free young person. Yeah. So to be able to live the life that you want to live rather than the life that you have to live. Yes. Haven't you noticed you want to do so many things, but by the time you get home in the evening, all you want to do is. Right? Yeah. Now, wouldn't it be nice to be able to do your domain expertise and yet have time, left over to do the things you want to do, really want to do. Yes? Now, this is available from learning how to meditate. Now, there is a quote by Gandhiji, very not well-known quote. Yes? Gandhiji once said that today I am so... Do you know he used to meditate every day? Few people know that. Yes? He used to do meditation, he used to do satsang. Both these things he used to do. Yes? Now, one day he says, today I am so busy, I cannot meditate my 1 hour. I will have to do 2 hours. Because meditation makes you efficient, super efficient. Yes? You know, as a student in IIT Bombay, just listen to what I used to do. I mean, I had my MSc maths that was like, okay. Yeah, and it's not an easy program. It's a tough program. All right? So I had my master's in maths. So I used to teach Art of Living. I used to have my whole MS maths. Yeah? I used to play competition level piano. Yes? I used to write, produce and direct my own plays. Yes? And I used to have time to sleep in the afternoon. You do maths, you don't have labs in the afternoon. So you can sleep. Yes? All these things I used to do. And there would be no problems. Okay? Now, this is where the choice comes. How much time, how much effort, how much money are you willing to invest to get to a life that you want to get to? Or would you rather compromise and be in the life that you are? There's nothing wrong. You are fairly successful. You are from a fairly good family. Life is good, right? But life can be excellent. If you have not done a Yes Plus course, do it. Yeah? It could make a huge difference in your life.